Get Rich Education is brought to you by Mid-South Homebuyers and thelandgeek.com.
Welcome to Get Rich Education with Keith Weinhold, giving you information and ideas on the investment that has turned more ordinary people into millionaires and billionaires than anything else, and can provide you with more wealth and happiness than you ever thought possible. Now, here's your host, investor, entrepreneur, business owner, and educator, Keith Weinhold.
Welcome to Get Rich Education. This is episode 41. I'm your host, Keith Weinhold. I'm here to make you more successful than me, faster than me. And with the content and the opportunity that you have today, there is perhaps a greater likelihood than ever of you becoming more successful than me, faster than me. I'm making the show that I wish I had a decade ago, and had I known about today's content a decade sooner, well, I might be in a different place today. We're going to discuss real estate syndication, where you aggregate investor money for bigger deals than you would have been able to do on your own. Today, we're helping dispel the myth of it takes money to make money. And we're talking to a teacher that's had a great influence on my life. You know, I'd have to say that the book Rich Dad Poor Dad had the greatest influence on my investing mindset and how I think abundantly. Well, years after that, the real estate guys, Robert Helms and Russell Gray, are really the ones that have helped me steer that abundance mentality into something actionable and profitable. We're going to go in depth with Russell Gray about how it absolutely doesn't take money to make money next. Are you looking for a way to build monthly cash flow investing in real estate, but without those typical hassles that you always hear about? You know, most people flock to compete in the house flipping and rental property markets, but now could be the time to learn something different. How about migraine-free real estate investing? In business for almost 15 years, Mark Podolsky, aka The Land Geek, he's unlocked the secrets to creating significant passive income by investing in raw, undeveloped land. There aren't any renters or tenants, no rodents or termites, no renovations or toilet repairs. Imagine achieving your financial goals without suffering through the constant stress that landlords and house flippers do. For more information, go to thelandgeek.com/GRE.
This is Rich Dad Advisor Ken McElroy. Listen to Get Rich Education with Keith Weinhold and don't quit your daydream.
Russell Gray is one half of the Real Estate Guys radio show. The other half is host Robert Helms. Russ is a financial strategist with a background in financial services dating back to 1986. Russ has got a great wealth of experience. He's owned his own mortgage company. He's taught real estate finance to realtors. He's a popular speaker and author. And, you know, maybe on a personal note to me, he's had as much or more influence on me than perhaps anyone I've had on the show yet to this point. That's why today I would like to welcome to Get Rich Education, Russell Gray.
Hey, Keith.
Hey, you know, it's great to have someone on the show who has had such an influence on me. So what have you been up to lately, Russ?
Well, you know, Robert and I crank out the radio show every week. And as you're finding out, that takes a little bit of work and effort lining up guests and running around the world, learning about new things. We go to a lot of conferences. I think probably the big guy that's been in the news a lot has been Donald Trump. We just came back from Freedom Fest, where we heard the Donald give his big speech, and that was a lot of fun. And while we were there, we talked to Steve Forbes and Peter Schiff and the usual gang. So it's a lot of fun. I mean, as you're finding out, being in the position that you're in, where you get a chance to talk with thought leaders and subject matter experts, it really compresses your learning curve and it adds a lot of value to your listeners. So I applaud you on the work that you're doing, because I know it's a lot of fun, but I also know it's a lot of work.
Yes, I found out both those things. Yeah, my show's had more reach than I expected, but it's more work than I ever expected either. It might compress one's learning, but it sure compresses the bookends of one's time, but it's totally worth it. One thing I know that you and Robert have been working on putting together is your next syndication event. So I wanted to get into that with you today. And I'm sure there's a segment of our listeners that still don't quite have their head wrapped around real estate syndication, perhaps. I didn't until just a few years ago. So when someone asks you, what is real estate syndication, what do you tell them?
We actually open up the seminar describing that because sometimes people have a misconception about what syndication is. They, especially when it comes to radio, they think syndication is just having radio shows all over the place, or they hear about the syndicate and they think it's the mob or the mafia. But really, a syndication is just a group of people that come together, usually for a financial reason. They're going to create a business together. They're going to create some type of an investment portfolio. They're going to do a project together, and they share the risks. They share the rewards. Everybody puts something in, and when it's all done, everybody gets something out.
Well, it's called real estate syndication. So just to break down the why behind that, you know, the first part of that is real estate. So why real estate? Why is now a time when one would potentially want to invest in real estate in a syndication or otherwise, when they weren't interested before? There wasn't a compelling reason to do so before.
I think real estate is an investment class. In fact, I'm just working on our latest newsletter and kind of going off on that topic. A journalist had written an article saying that Donald Trump would be worth $20 billion if he would have taken his money 30 years ago and just stuck it in the S&P index fund and let it sit. And I kind of rebutting that comment for a lot of different reasons. But at the end of the day, real estate is real. It serves a basic human need. It's not a fad. It isn't going anywhere. Nobody's going to come up with some technology that's going to make real estate obsolete or somehow have it not be an important part of human existence. Everybody's going to need a place to live, place to work, place to shop, place to go on vacation. Real estate is part and parcel, an integral part of human existence. And so for that reason alone, it's a solid investment. And then, of course, each individual property, and this is my favorite thing about real estate, is unique. It's unique right down to the neighborhood, the floor plan, the structure, the condition, the ownership circumstances. And because of the inherent inefficiencies in real estate, unlike the stock or paper asset markets that are traded on these lightning fast exchanges where everybody has equal opportunity, real estate doesn't. It's an insider's game. If you have a relationship, if you know something a little bit more than the other guy, things that might get you in trouble in the stock market actually create opportunity for you in real estate. And you can exploit those inefficiencies to pick up bargains, create better cash flows. And even if you're just flipping property, you buy cheap and sell it a little bit more because you were able to get an inside deal. So real estate is a very effective investment vehicle, whether you're looking to create short-term profits or long-term cash flows.
Yeah, it seemed to me like the argument that can be made that elevating one's education in real estate can help them more on a time invested basis than elevating one's education in other asset classes.
Well, yeah, I mean, you've got all the tax advantages too, and you've got subsidized debt. You know, the Fannie and Freddie are offering lower than market rates on mortgages. So there's a lot of different advantages to being involved in real estate. You know, Robert and I talk all the time about how you kind of have the big dogs on your side. You know, we found that out in the 2008 crisis when the mortgage industry imploded and took the real estate market with it. You know, you saw a lot of talk from the central banks, the Federal Reserve, talking about how they need to prop up real estate. You saw the dropping of interest rates. You saw a private industry, banking, politicians, political activism groups. I mean, everybody rallied around real estate. And, you know, if you're going to be investing in any type of an asset class, and I don't really consider real estate an asset class because of the inherent inefficiencies that I already mentioned, but if you're going to be investing in anything, it's good to have the powers that be on your side and not working against you.
Yes, so real estate has such tremendous advantages, Russ, and I've probably spent 40 plus shows now really revolving around the compelling why and how real estate, in a sense, really pays an investor five ways at the same time when one controls their own deal and so on. But we've touched on syndication a little bit, but we've been talking mostly about controlling one's own deals. So what's really a compelling reason for one to syndicate?
You know, that's a great question, Keith. And we got really interested in syndication many years ago. I mean, I think the obvious progression is you go out there and you start doing real estate deals and quickly run out of money and run out of credit of your own. And then you're either going to sit on the sideline and wait and recycle your own credit and recycle your own money or try to save up some more money from operations or maybe whatever else you do. Some people flip properties to create additional down payment capital to purchase more long-term buy and hold properties. But The idea of syndication is just to go out and raise other people's money. So we're used to going to the bank and getting a loan, but not so much going and raising the equity from private investors. And really, that's kind of where syndications start. Investors are starving for yield, even though lending has come back, which is fine if you want to borrow. As far as investors, they've got a couple of choices. They can invest in a stock market, which is arguably at bubble highs and a little bit nerve-wracking if you're afraid of heights. And then you've got low interest rates on savings and bonds. And so where is a saver supposed to put their money? And a lot of people are innately interested in real estate, but they don't want to get their hands dirty. It's something that they're not familiar with. They're looking for more of what we call a coupon clipping experience. They want to write a check, turn it over to somebody, let that person, you know, make money for them and send them a check back. That's why mutual funds are popular, why financial advisors are popular. But all those guys play in the paper asset space. They don't really give you the opportunity to take advantage of real estate. The only exception to that is REITs, real estate investment trusts. But the problem with those is they're very heavily laden with fees. And then you also don't get to benefit from some of the insider deals or inefficiencies because REITs are publicly traded, and then that puts them in the same category as stocks where everybody has equal access. So when you get involved in a private syndication, now you have an opportunity to get involved in kind of an inside deal. You get to look at the deal ahead of time. You get to understand what it's all about, how the deal is going to get put together. You probably have a personal relationship with the person who's running the deal, so you have a good feel for whether or not this person is competent and trustworthy. And usually there's a specific time horizon. You know, we're going to be in this deal for a year. We're going to be in it for 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, whatever it is. And then the responsibility then is just simply to make sure that you match up what you want your money to do for you versus what the deal is intended to do. When you get that match, now you have a good basis for doing a deal together.
Now, it seems to me when one first becomes interested in syndication, that person is typically at the point where they've done some successful real estate investing themselves. So they understand the power of real estate investing, but they just don't have that down payment to get the next property themselves. So up to this point, maybe they had been putting 20% down on a property and borrowing 80%, and now they see a way in which they can basically borrow 100%, 80% from the bank and 20% from investors. But I think a common question that brings some trepidation or some doubt into the mind of that person that's been a successful real estate investor but thinks about being a syndicator is really that question in their mind, you know, do I really own enough income property to be a successful syndicator? And it probably comes down to building your brand for that person to have the confidence that they can demonstrate proof of concept to others in order to syndicate bigger deals to others. So what would you say to somebody that isn't sure whether they have enough property in their portfolio or not, or if they don't have enough, what they can do to build their brand and go ahead and convey that confidence to a prospective investor?
That's kind of a direct feed into me. You know, my whole talk or one of my major talks at the syndication seminar is all about building your brand and building your network. So no matter where you are on the food chain right now, that's something you can start doing right away. You have to build your brand or build your reputation, if you will, in two major ways. You have to be able to demonstrate that you're competent, that you know what you're doing, and you have to demonstrate that you're trustworthy, that you're somebody who is not there to take. If you can demonstrate those two things, then you have a legitimate chance at earning somebody's trust and being worthy of it. Now, how do you get there? Well, obviously, the more experience you have, the smarter you're going to be. You know, and so if you've been investing for a number of years, if you've done a lot of deals, you have a track record, that's great. But if you don't have that, is there a way to shortcut it? And I would say the answer is yes, because my theory is anything that you don't have, you can buy or borrow. In other words, my father was a high-tech entrepreneur in Silicon Valley, but he's not an engineer. And so he owned a company and started a company that manufactured semiconductors. Well, how did he do that? He raised money and he hired the best engineers. So is it possible for you as a syndicator to raise money and then hire the best real estate developer or hire the best house flipper or partner with somebody who has a much bigger and better track record than you do? So now what you are is you're an organizer, which is really what an entrepreneur is. An entrepreneur is the person who kind of sees the big picture, puts all the pieces together and leads the team. So you don't necessarily have to have that firsthand experience as the guy who's going to be operating the deal if you can raise enough money to pay for the guy who can do the deal. And then you just make sure that there is something in it for everybody. You know, if you have it too loaded up with experts, you know, your margins as the organizer are going to be much thinner. But you have to ask yourself, would I rather have a small percentage of something or a whole lot of nothing, right? If you don't do anything, you got nothing. So at least if you do something, you can do it. So your team is way more important than your own personal resume. I guess that's the point that I'm trying to make.
So that way you've just built your brand through association.
Absolutely.
So one thing that I learned when I attended the last Secrets of Successful Syndication seminar that you and Robert hosted a few months ago is that one low pressure way for a new syndicator to break in, when that syndicator has a prospective investor, don't go show them the deal that you're thinking about putting together. Instead, a much more low pressure approach is to show prospective investors a past deal. That way there's no pressure on the investor. And you can just simply say to that prospective investor, hey, if I find an investment like this, would you be interested in something like this?
Yeah, that's such a great point. It does. It takes all the pressure off, not only you, but off the customer. Because at the end of the day, this is about looking for matches. And you're building your business in two basic components. You're building a network of investors who have money that is looking for a home, some place to go to work, and you're looking for a network of providers or deal flow, people who have deals that your investors can invest in. And when you put those two things together, you have a viable business. And so you're always cultivating relationships on both sides. And that's really the core thing. This is a relationship business. You can spend a lot of time turning over rocks by yourself looking for deals, or you can plug into people who do that for a living and have a good relationship with them, and then they feed you deals. So when you're working with your investor network, to your point, Keith, when you're out there talking to people, you're just trying to figure out if they're even interested in growing their wealth. Some people are, some people aren't. How they respond to you will tell you a little bit about who they are and how they perceive you. When someone says, well, yes, what did you have in mind? And you start talking to them, your idea of talking about case studies. Well, for example, you know, my partners and I did this deal and we went in and we built this apartment building, or we converted this piece of land, or we did whatever we did, and we made X amount of money. Those are the types of deals we do. Would anything like that be interesting to you? If someone says, well, yeah, I'd love to see that. Great. Well, then, you know, the next time I have a deal like that, I'll bring it to you. And of course, it's a lot bigger than that, because you really have to talk about matching up risk tolerances and investment durations and all those types of things. But the idea is that when you're in a conversation with somebody, you don't have to have something to sell, because it isn't about you talking. It's about you listening. And listening to what that person is trying to accomplish in their financial life. And then either you have something that can help them, or you can go find something that can help them, or you can refer them to somebody who can help them. But it's about you as a syndicator helping people achieve their financial goals through whatever means you can. And if you do enough of that, to quote Zig Ziglar, if you help enough other people get what they want out of life, you'll get what you want out of life.
Yeah, that is one of my favorite quotes. That's right on our Get Rich Education homepage. Love that one. You know, and I think what is of some surprise to some syndicators, you know, they're always concerned with how am I going to find the money? I'm maybe nervous about asking someone for money for the deal. But often the truth is, there is more money than there are deals.
Yes, absolutely. Especially because they're printing all kinds of it. I mean, that's really how the mortgage industry blew up. You know, the central banks printed a bunch of money to stimulate the economy, and it all ends up in the system. And every time money ends up at a bank, it's not an asset to the bank, it's a liability. And they have to create an offsetting asset, which to them is a loan. So they have to make loans. And when they have too much money pumped into the system, they have to start making loans to anybody or anything they can find. And sometimes those lending standards get so low, it gets dangerous. They start lowering interest rates because they don't even want your money. It's like, you know what, just go away. I've got too much money as it is. It sounds counterintuitive, but that's kind of the way it works. So again, you know, that creates a lot of opportunity, because there is a lot of money floating around in the system that is looking for a home, and it's starving for yield. Real estate, as you've mentioned, makes money in many ways, from the tax deductions to the passive income to the amortization and the leverage, appreciation. You can force equity by doing improvements. There's so many different ways to extract value, financial value from real estate, that a syndicator should be able to go into the marketplace with many compelling offerings. The challenge, to your point, is that there is more money than you think and not enough deals. But again, if you're doing a good job and you are performing well for your providers, the people who are bringing you the deals, if you're really taking the deals and you're closing on the deals and you're doing more deals, you're going to end up moving to the front of the line. You always can get your unfair advantage if you perform and if you conduct yourself honorably and if you really develop the relationships and make sure that every deal you do has winners all the way around. If you negotiate from a win-lose position, then people aren't going to be around. For example, if your real estate guy is bringing you a deal and you're constantly trying to get him to reduce his commission, you're moving to the back of the line.
Right.
Conversely, if your guy's bringing deals and you can afford to spiff him a little bit by paying him even more than what he's asking, you're going to move to the front of the line. You say, well, why would I want to pay more? To be at the front of the line. It's the same reason, you know, you pull into a big club at Las Vegas and you throw the valet $20 so you don't have to walk half an hour. I mean, that's why you do it. You know, the valet's full. Well, my friend Andrew here says it's open. Oh, yeah, I guess it is.
Yep, that's what we call the ROTI, one of my favorite metrics here at Get Rich Education. What's your return on time invested? That's really what it all comes down to.
Yeah.
So, you know, we've talked a little bit about some good relatively low pressure strategies for obtaining money from investors. But if one can find money more easily than the deal, then how does one find a deal? What are some good strategies for finding a large multifamily apartment building or what have you?
Well, I think the first thing is to pick a niche and commit to it. And so think strategically about your niche. And it can be a geographic niche. Probably should be to start with, so that you understand the macro market drivers that your property is going to be floating in, if you will. And then determine your submarkets, build your team. And these are people who are all going to have active relationships in that marketplace. And then your product type. And the product type, whichever type of product type you're going to get involved in, probably has some type of network of specialty agents and people who are in that sub industry. So, you know, if you're a multifamily guy, you're part of the National Apartment Association and you're interacting with property managers and you're going to trade shows and you're getting yourself into the culture, the subculture of the multifamily community in a particular geography. It could be true of mobile home parks. It could be true of single family homes. It could be true of self-storage centers. Could be true of raw land, going to the auctions, whatever it is, you get yourself ingrained and become part of that culture. And that's why it's real important when you're picking out what you're going to do. It's not just the financial rewards and potential, but it's also the demographic, the types of people that you want to spend your time with, because you're going to need to become friends with these people. The key to getting into the deal is getting into the culture and becoming friends with the people who have access to the deals, who have their thumb on the pulse of the market, and who have the relationships with the owners who can bring you the opportunities. You know, guys in the 1031 exchange space are a great place to find opportunities because they have somebody who's come to them and said, hey, I'm going to be selling my property and I want to do a 1031 exchange to whatever or wherever. And so they're doing the homework on the front end, talking to their 1031 guy or their tax guy, and that guy knows that a deal's coming before anybody else. And so that's just an example of how a relationship can bring you opportunities. If you take good care of the guy, and you don't have to give him money, right? I mean, you can refer somebody business. And that's one way we talk about tipping your service providers. You know, your service providers get paid by providing services. And if you've already used their services and you're in between deals and you want to keep the relationship going and keep your name at the top of their list, send them your referrals because you win their favor that way.
You know, I think most people realize that most people go out and work for money, and that's why they don't become wealthy. No one gets wealthy just working for money. But the enlightening thing to some people is no one gets wealthy, really, except maybe in a rare case, having their money work for them either. You know, it's a real light bulb moment for some people when they realize that once you get other people's money to work for you, that's how sustainable generational wealth is obtained. And real estate syndication is getting other people's money to work for you really in a 100% fashion rather than an 80% fashion. And that light bulb moment can be just as big for the person that learns about syndication for the first time as the person that learns about other people's money for the first time. So syndication, that's an opportunity. You know, opportunities and ideas are like a little hinge, and little hinges open up big doors. So, you know, really in the motivation for being a syndicator, and this is sort of the architecture of the syndication deal here, Russ, how does a syndicator actually make money?
Another great question. You've got to be able to eat as you go along, right? So right. In the beginning, I had a friend who would go out there and raise a bunch of money, and he wanted to make all his money on the back end, which was great, except that these were 2 and 3 year projects. And meanwhile, he had to run the company. He had to do investor updates and provide accounting and maintain the office and the phone and all that. And he had a major cash flow problem. So you can make money with a promote, and that's where you take a little bit of money off the money coming in order to pay for having raised the money. In the mutual fund world, that's called a load. It's a sales commission. It's what brings the money to the mutual fund manager. You'd never want to overload something, but you will have costs of raising money, especially if you're doing any type of marketing or solicitation to accredited investors or running any type of event. So you're going to have that. And if you operate it well, you can make a little bit of money on that. And it's not so much profit. It's more building up a war chest for your next project. Then you can make money on a management fee. And that's the way a lot of mutual fund managers make money. They collect a point or two on all of the funds under management. You can do it with profit sharing. So you may give your investor a preferred return. They get maybe the first 6 or 8%. And anything over that, you split 50-50 or 80-20 or 70-25, whatever the market will bear, whatever all the parties agree to is fair. There is no magic formula. But it's a way to be rewarded for doing a great job and to reward your investors by giving them the opportunity to eat first. They get all their money back plus a preferred return before you eat. All you get is your management fees along the way. And then you can get transactional fees. It may be that there's extra work to be done when you acquire as far as the due diligence or when you have to conduct a sale or a refinance, and you may charge a fee for handling that transaction because it's a lot more involved than just, collecting the rents or overseeing the development of the project or whatever. Developer fees is another way. These are the fees that a real estate developer would collect when they are organizing the project. They're not doing the construction. They're not doing the architecture. They're doing all those things, but they collect a fee for doing the development, putting it all together. And so, there's lots of different ways. The thing you want to do is you want to be fair. You need to be completely transparent. You can't ever have hidden compensation. And you've got to give your investors a good return, a competitive return for their money. You know, if they see you running around in a Ferrari and driving a private jet and they're getting, weak yields, then your reputation is going to go downhill fast. You don't want to be too flashy. You want to do a good job for people. You want to earn your money by adding a lot of value. But you also need to make sure that you've built into your business model a way to fund all of the components that are necessary. Money is like blood, and it has to circulate in an organization in order to make sure that all of the functions work, right? If you have a circulation problem in your body, pretty soon, you get gangrene and your organs or whatever. I mean, everything starts to die. The same thing's true in your organization. If you haven't created an allocation in your business model to raise the money, then you're not going to have money to raise money. And then pretty soon the money's going to dry up. If you don't have a model for investor relations, then when investors are calling and asking questions, you don't have anybody there to answer the phone or any way to create a newsletter or a video or any type of an update. I mean, all of these things cost money. So you really have to think it through when you put your model together to make sure that you've allocated enough. A lot of guys go, oh, I can make all this money on this deal. But when they really get down to it, they realize there's really not enough meat on the bone for them to do it. And they either have to negotiate a better deal or use more leverage or lower their interest expense or find some way to be more efficient. That's probably one of the things that only comes with experience and why it's important to have either an experienced mentor or somebody who's, been down the path before that can look over what you're doing and make sure that you haven't missed something obvious that's going to put you and your investors at a disadvantage. You might mean well, but that's where your inexperience can be exposed.
So you mentioned a preferred return, and a preferred return that you might offer to a prospective investor could be a number like 8%. And above and beyond that 8%, there could be something like a 50-50 split where any profits above that, you and the investor split them. To me, that probably seems like a very good idea. I think that demonstrates to the investor that you have a vested interest on achieving the highest return possible, and that way you both benefit with that 50-50 split above and beyond the preferred 8% return that you offered to them.
Absolutely. I mean, the key is that you have to create a financial model, as I just mentioned, that pays for everything that needs to be done, but also motivates people to perform well. And you obviously are the director of everything going on. And when you have a business model, a financial model that you can explain to your investor, look, Mr. Investor, here's where my motivation is. I'm motivated to get you at least 8% because I really don't eat until I get past that. Now, with that said, if the preferred return is too high or your motivation is too much, you might find yourself tempted to take unnecessary risks. So you can swing the pendulum the other way. But the basic premise is your model, your financial model, needs to make sense to your investor, and it needs to make sense to you, and it needs to demonstrate to your investor that your financial interests are aligned with theirs, not in competition with theirs. That's kind of the fundamental point.
All right, so if a successful syndicator has matched up the money with the deal and the deal's closed, you know, the prospective syndicator's got to be wondering, all right, well, what am I really doing with my time over, say, a 5-year hold period or a proposed 7-year hold period in the syndication? What does a syndicator actually do once the deal's closed?
Well, first and foremost, they hold the people who are doing whatever needs to be done to make money accountable. And so it's very much like being a CEO. It's the responsibility of identifying what's important, of creating metrics to measure that those things are being done, and then holding those people accountable to getting it done. The other part of it is investor relations, is reporting back to your investors what's happening, because people get nervous. And when they don't hear from you, they assume the worst. And things that are little can become very big, big problems.
Yeah.
So those are two of the major things. And then, of course, you've got the tax returns and the accounting and the paperwork and all of that. So those are probably the three major things that you're doing, you know, even when you're kind of in the lull in a project.
I just thought of one question. Does the syndicator need to seek any specific qualifications with the investor? Like, does the investor need to meet the SEC's definition of an accredited investor, or is there any bar to clear or anything like that? Like, how much does a syndicator really need to vet the investor? Can they let the investor invest as much as they possibly want to, or how does that look?
That is another amazingly great question, Keith, and one you can get into a lot of trouble with, because you'll get people who come in who have the money, but they really don't have the sophistication or the temperament. You're recruiting partners. And even though they're silent partners and they're limited and they don't necessarily have control, they do have rights, and they can make your life miserable if they're nervous Nellies, if they just are not sophisticated enough to even understand when you're guiding them through maybe a rough patch. What's really important is you need to make sure that their investment objectives and timing match up with what you're doing. You know, if somebody says, for example, gives you, well, I've got this fund for my kid's college, he's 16 years old, and I want to invest it in your project because you're promoting a 20% annualized return. But your project is a 5-year project, and the kid's going to school in 2 years, and they come to you 2 years later, and they want their money. And they're like, well, I told you it was for my kid's college. And you're like, well, no, I mean, I told you it was a 5-year project. See, now you've got a mismatch, and now you've got a problem. So that's one issue. You mentioned accredited investors. This one's huge, and it's actually a huge opportunity. In September of 2013, new regulations came out from the SEC, which basically removed the ban on general solicitation for accredited investors. And for people who don't know the definition of accredited investor, even why it exists, the definition is an accredited investor is someone who has a net worth excluding their personal residence of $1 million or more. They're deemed to be either sophisticated, or at least they have enough wealth that if they lose some money, they can afford to lose it. So I don't know where the SEC comes up with it, but that's their definition. Another way is if someone's earning $200,000 a year and has for the last couple of years, or $300,000 for a couple, and has a reasonable expectation of earning that same amount of money in the upcoming year. In that case, they're considered to be accredited. And so that means you can run ads, you can hold dinner meetings and seminars and invite people who you've never met before to come in, and you're exempt from some of the public registration rules. And that's a whole topic in itself, and I'm not a lawyer, so I won't get into it. But that's the basic definition. Someone who isn't an accredited investor is got a lot of quote-unquote protections under the law, which basically blocks them from participating in these things. They can go buy, you know, an IPO. They can go buy the latest hot stock. They can go do a lot of what I would consider to be fairly reckless and foolish things, as long as it's publicly registered. But they can't get involved in these insider deals with people that they know and deals that they can see, unless they have a pre-existing personal relationship. And even when that's true, there's a limit to how many people you can put into any particular deal or series of deals. And so you just need to work really carefully with your securities attorney to make sure that you understand those rules and you follow them carefully, because those are the things that end up getting you in trouble innocently. It's just a matter of not knowing what the law is and then putting the wrong people in the deal. And here's the danger. If you put too many non-accrediteds in a deal, then you may have to refund somebody their money on demand. And the challenge with a lot of these projects is they're not going to be liquid enough to do that. And then it can be a real problem. And it's really a problem in case the investment didn't perform as you had hoped, because now everybody who's in the deal can get out of it. And then it's a big mess. So you want to make sure that you're picking people that you want to be in business with, that you want to be friends with and communicate with. People that aren't going to drive you crazy. You want to make sure that they're qualified under the law and you understand those rules. And I think the last thing is just making sure that it's suitable for the person. And, you know, it's their money and they get to do what they want to do. And there aren't really any hard and fast rules. But if you can imagine yourself having to explain to a judge, maybe in a civil suit, why you took 100% of somebody's retirement and exposed it to one single deal. You never want to do that, right? I mean, it's too risky. So you have to make decisions. One time we had a guy come to us. He wanted to give us 100%, $1.8 million of his retirement. He wanted to give it to us for a project we were doing. We really wanted to take it. I mean, that was great. A $1.8 million investment. We said, no, we can't do that. We took $800,000, which was a lot, but it was less than 50% of his liquid net worth. And it was less than, I don't know, maybe 20% of his total net worth. And so, you know, you want to protect yourself from that. Remember, even though you are bullish on what you're doing, you believe in what you're doing, everything is rosy, everything is sunshine and rainbows, and you think everything is going to be wonderful, the fact of the matter is investing involves risk, and there are things out of your control. And when things happen that are outside of your control and somebody loses money, you have, I think, a moral responsibility at least to make sure that you haven't expose somebody to more risk than they could afford to absorb on any one deal. And so the suitability issue is an important one as well.
Yeah, that's really important to say. You know, we want to acquire wealth here by creating value for others, not creating undue risk for others. So yeah, you really don't want to take some nice little old lady's last dime to put into your deal. Because like we said, there's really plenty of money out there, often more money than deals. So finding the money, as counterintuitive as that might seem, really isn't the problem. So what about the money, Russ? I mean, how much money can one make being a syndicator? I know that's an it depends question if there ever was one. There's got to be a pretty good return for the person's time.
In terms of how much money you can make, I mean, it's really literally unlimited. You know, I was just talking earlier about this article, about this newspaper article I saw saying Donald Trump could have made twice as much money. 20 billion versus 10 billion or whatever it is, as though, you know, all those billions weren't enough money. Donald Trump wrote the book, The Art of the Deal, and he's been touting that out on the campaign trail. But he also wrote a book called The Art of the Comeback is because in the savings and loan crisis, which was like the predecessor, the small predecessor of the big mortgage crisis that we had in 2008, when that happened, he had a negative net worth of $900 million. I don't know if you knew that, but Robert and I saw him talk at a speech one time, and he said, yeah, I'm walking down the street in New York City with my then wife, Marla, and he sees this guy there with a little pencil cup, you know, begging for money on the side of the street in New York City. And he says, you know what? That guy is worth more than I am because he's only zero, right? I'm minus $900 million. Right. But see, because of syndication, Donald Trump was able to completely rebuild his life. He didn't have any money to invest. He had nothing but debt, but he had his reputation. He had his know-how. He had his team. He had his relationships, and he was able to raise money from investors, go do more deals, make profits, not only dig himself out of the hole, but get the lessons and rebuild a bigger, stronger portfolio and company with more net worth and more cash flows than when it all blew up on him. And that's really the power of syndication. So no matter where you are sitting, you're probably not at minus $900 million. And so if he can do it, you know, theoretically, you can do it too. And it was really non-monetary things that allowed him to do that. It was, again, his knowledge, his relationships, his team, and his hustle that got him to do it. And so in terms of syndication, I mean, really, literally, the sky's the limit. All the money in the world there is, theoretically, you could go raise if you had the right deals. It's never going to happen, but you'll never run out of things. You'll never run out of things to do. You can make tons and tons of money. And I think the thing that's important, though, is that you do it for the right reasons. You know, you look at a guy like Steve Jobs or Bill Gates back in the day, Donald Trump. These guys, Robert Kiyosaki, these are guys that have made enough money to quit working a long, 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 long time ago. But they never quit. They kept going because they believed in what they were doing. They were passionate about it. It fulfilled them. They were working for purpose, not for money. The problem is if you become a syndicator for the money, thinking if I can just make enough money, then I can live how I want to live, I would say don't even do it. I would say spend your time and effort trying to figure out how you want to live and then building a business around living that way, because then you're retired from the beginning. You know, when the mortgage industry blew up and I lost my mortgage company in that, it failed because the mortgage company died. And so when it failed, I had the great opportunity to reinvent myself. And I really asked myself that question. I said, knowing what I now know about myself and how I want to live, how can I design a business that will let me live that way? And that's what I did. Maybe I don't make as much money as the next guy, but I don't care. I'm rich because I live how I want to live and I get paid to live that way. Syndication can give you lots of freedom. If you like to travel, if you like to look at different places, if you like to interact with different people, if you like to have the flexibility over your schedule, it can give you a lot of those things. But it's also going to come with some strings attached. You know, you're going to have responsibility to investors. If you want to be completely your own person and not have to answer to anybody, you're not going to like syndication because you answer to those investors. You have an obligation to them. You also have responsibilities under the law that you can't shirk. You've got to take care of those things or you're going to end up in trouble. So it isn't for everybody, but compared to what a lot of people are doing for a living, you know, sitting in a cubicle somewhere, working for somebody they don't like or respect, doing a job that really doesn't fulfill them, just living for the weekends, I mean, it can be a fabulous lifestyle. And from a money perspective, yes, you can make a lot of money. So when you're not actively doing syndication, you do have a lot of money to enjoy on your time off.
Well, you're really helping to make a difference in people's lives with the syndication event. It continues to get more popular, seemingly, as people really see this as the next thing and the next level. So, hey, Russell, how can a listener find out more about you? And can you tell us just a little bit more about your Secrets of Successful Syndication event?
Finding us is easy. The Real Estate Guys radio show can be found on iTunes or Stitcher or at our website at realestateguysradio.com. If you end up in iTunes, you're going to find over 300 episodes and all kinds of fun guests and topics. As far as the event itself, it's evolved over time and it's been a lot of fun. We mix up the faculty to bring different perspectives. This upcoming event that we've got in August features Ken McElroy, who is Robert Kiyosaki's real estate advisor and a big, big time syndicator. Started out with one 2-unit rental property and was doing property management. Pretty soon he started investing in his own account, ran out of money and started raising money. And that's where he met Robert Kiyosaki as one of his investors. And of course, they have gone on to do hundreds of millions of dollars. And Kenny owns tens of thousands of units or these thousands of units through his company, MC Companies. And so he's got a lot of practical street smarts in the multifamily. But we bring other people in who have syndicated internationally, people who do specialty products like assisted living or offshore farmland. I mean, there's all kinds of different things you can do with syndication. And so we like to do these case studies. And we get people to come back time and time and time again because they're changing. So, you know, maybe the first time they see it, they're just trying to understand what syndication is and getting the basics. Then they go out and they do a small one and they kind of get a feel for it. And then they come back and they learn a little bit more. And even if it's something we said the last time, they've got ears to hear it now. And another big part of the event is the networking. So it's a two-day event. We typically will get in there on a Thursday night. And then if for people who are there, we'll hang out, maybe have a beer or something together and just do some networking. Next morning, we are in the classroom early. We go all day from like 8 to 6. Then we do a cocktail reception that evening and hang out, more networking. Next morning, back in the classroom all day long again. And a lot of guys hang out even another day, maybe explore the market or just get together socially with some new friends that they've met. And so it's just a ton of fun. We do it in different places. This time we're going to be in Dallas, Texas. Mauricio Raul, who is our attorney who handles explaining the SEC rules and how to set up asset protection structures to protect both you and your investors. As I mentioned, we're going to have other people who are in niche products who are going to talk a little bit about how their products create opportunity. So it's an opportunity not only to learn and network, but you get a chance to actually meet people who can be providers of future deal flow for you. So when you look at that, you go, oh, could I raise money to do a deal like that? Yeah, I could. Now you've got a place to go. Because sometimes people are like, hey, I've got money. I know people who have money. Where do I find the deal? That gets answered. For other people, are like, hey, I can see there's lots of deals. How do I raise the money? We talk about that too. So it's all there. And we've had guys come in and take this class. In fact, I just went to a training class in Phoenix, and one of our listeners was there, and I was just taking the class too. And I said, hey, you look really familiar to me. He goes, oh, I came to your Secrets of Successful Syndication seminar a couple years ago. I said, oh, how'd that go? He goes, it went great. 8 months later, I was out of the rat race. I quit my job, and I was doing syndicate, raised $5 million. I was like, wow, an indication seminar cost you. And it's a lot more expensive now. But at that time, he bought in at the earliest level and he paid like $500. Pretty good return on investment, I'd say.
Well, if you like the way this sounds and you just kind of want this discussion to continue, you should attend the Real Estate Guys Secrets of Successful Syndication event in Dallas, Texas. It's August 21st and 22nd. So to find out more and really learn everything that you need to know to make big dollars doing big deals, go ahead to getricheducation.com and click on the events page or send an email to syndication@getricheducation.com where you're going to be sent all the details. I had a great experience when I went to the syndication event, just like I do at every Real Estate Guys event. I mean, look, one way that you're going to benefit by attending an event in person is that you will expand your network. You know, you just can't do that remotely. You know, and then either those people or people in their network, they could even turn out to be the investors in your deal. So the networking component is so important, and it's something that you just can't get sitting at home. You know, in fact, fully one third of the guests that I've had on Get Rich Education are people that I've met at Real Estate Guys events. So I really recommend that you go to the syndication event. I think your mind and your context are going to be expanded. You know, sometimes people say that they want more real estate in their portfolio, but they don't have the money to add more. And those same people say they would learn a new skill if they had to in order to earn some more income from real estate, but then they don't attend something like this. So I'm saying, don't be that person. Attend the syndication event. So again, go to getricheducation.com and click on the events page or send an email to syndication@getricheducation.com and then you will be sent back a reply in return with all of the details there. Russell Gray, thank you so much for stopping by. It's been insightful as always.
Thanks, Keith. It was awesome.
Well, that was a terrific overview on real estate syndication from a top teacher in the entire real estate investing industry. Now, syndication isn't always easy, and it isn't for everybody. And I guess you could say that about most any worthwhile endeavor, really. Your number one investment in your life is you. And, you know, when well-accomplished people look back on their life and career, they often say that the best investment that they ever made was in their own education. And, you know, the people that attend these types of events are so approachable, friendly, and helpful. Oh, and I also expect International Coffee Farms founder David Sewell to be at the event and present about coffee as well, so you should at least meet David there too, which has got to be of interest for those listeners that are also Panama Coffee Farm investors. Go to our website events page where you'll see the syndication event. And there are three events listed there. Now, two of those events are $10,000 events. That's how much it costs to attend each one of those. I'm going to one of those $10,000 events and Get Rich Education's John Collins is going to the other. Now, 10K is a lot of money and not everyone can swing that. I get that. Well, the syndication event is a fraction of the cost of those other events. And Russ told me off microphone that if you register by July 31st, you get an additional discount when you register through either the events page at getricheducation.com or sending that email to syndication@getricheducation.com. I really thank Russell Gray for providing that discount and for making his GRE debut today. You will change your life, your context, and your network at the syndication event next month in Dallas. I want to see you be more successful than me, faster than me. Next Friday, I'm going to talk to another great guest that has advised Presidents Obama and Bush on finance. That ought to be fun. Until then, I'm your host, Keith Weinhold. Don't quit your daydream.
You've been listening to Get Rich Education, telling you what the wealthy won't tell you about real estate and investing. If you enjoyed the show, please take a minute to visit iTunes and leave your comments.
Nothing on this show should be considered specific, personal, or professional advice. Please consult an appropriate tax, legal, real estate, financial, or business professional for individualized advice. Opinions of guests are their own. Information is not guaranteed. All investment strategies have the potential for profit or loss. The host is operating on behalf of Get Rich Education, LLC, exclusively.